Today marks the launch of NVIDIA's RTX 3000 series graphics cards, more specifically the Founders Edition. The aftermarket board partner cards will be coming in about a day, so make sure you stay tuned for that one. But right here we've got the RTX 3080 Founders with a fan on the bottom, a fan on the top. We checked out the cooling temperatures and they were absolutely fine. The fan noise likes to sit around 50% out of the box on the auto fan profiles, which makes the card pretty quiet in operation and going up to about 75 degrees C. Honestly, if you are loving the look of this card and it is your choice, then I would honestly suggest out of the box, just leaving it as it is, because out of the box, it runs really well. You don't need to overclock it. The performance, which we'll show right now, is really, really good. And looking at the 4K numbers straight away, this is what we're going to go into first. Going over 8 different titles here, it is just that league above, not just everything else, but its closest competition, the 2080 Ti. And I had to go back and check these numbers again, because on average at 4K, I was getting roughly 40% more performance than the previous predecessor, the 2080 Ti. And so this card right here will offer you that 4K experience and what I'm calling the 4K revolution, because they've put the HDMI 2.1 on the back and they've also got 3 DisplayPort connections too. And so in my previous video, I coupled this graphics card with a HDMI 2.1 cable and I hooked it up to the LG monitors or the gaming TVs that were 55 inch and 65 inch. And they were rumored to have true 120 Hertz 4K support with their HDMI 2.1. And the truth is it did work and you were getting 120 Hertz indeed at 4K. And quite simply, this card right here has the grunt to be able to power 4K 120 Hertz properly, which is the most impressive thing. I think as a PC gamer, I've been in this whole industry for so long and you just keep seeing the same TN panels and VA panels being thrown in your face. And then of course, it's all 1080p and 1440p. This 4K OLED display, coupled with the power behind this thing, really is taking gaming to a whole new level, to the point where I've gone and ordered my own straight away off eBay. I went and ordered a 55-inch CX OLED TV to couple with this graphics card, because my brother, he had the C9 65-inch OLED, and I was just really, really enjoying my first experience at a 4K 120 Hertz OLED. I was playing CSGO, and even that game, as old as it is, was so enjoyable. However, I wanted to talk about the 4K gaming numbers first, because I feel like that's the person who's going to get the most out of the RTX 3080. If you're a 1080p gamer, especially if you've got a 120 Hertz monitor, 240 Hertz monitor, you might be better off just sticking with what you've got, or of course, looking on the used market for a bargain to come up, because these cards are that powerful. When we're pulling up some of the 1080p numbers here, we are becoming CPU bound in a lot of cases. And this is a 10900K already running at 5 gigahertz. And we've got 32 gigabytes, 3600 megahertz, CL16 memory. So basically we've got the best setup you can get pretty much for gaming. And at 1080p, this graphics card is pretty much pushing the CPU to the point where it can't provide enough FPS for this thing to process. However, the flip side to 1080p gaming is that some games will be able to run really high FPS. And so if you want to get a 360 Hertz monitor and put all the settings to ultra or high settings, then this card will, in certain games, and of course it depends on the game, will allow you to do that. And moving through the 1440p numbers, after the 1080p analysis and the 4K analysis, they're of course somewhere in between. However, I will note that if you want to get, say, a super ultra wide 49 inch monitor, which I believe has the base vertical resolution of 1440, then this card will provide that FPS, where I think the total resolution is coming close to that of 4K. So you will need a power hungry GPU to power all those pixels. So the gaming performance numbers are absolutely phenomenal coming out of this graphics card. Now the cooler itself, it weighs in at 1360 grams. I'll put the dimensions up here on the screen for you. Also the clock speeds in real time practice testing at 4K, they went up to about 1980 megahertz. And then the memory is running at 19 gigabits per second effective. Though the Founders Edition in particular will pay attention to this little connector right here, it does indeed need that 12 pin connector, which is included in the box. And then you plug that from two 8-pin connectors, and it does plug right into the middle of the graphics card as shown here. And the one thing I see with this is that they've got the RTX GeForce logo here, which lights up, but then these cables are pretty much going to cover it, and you kind of don't want to maneuver it too much, because I feel like if you maneuver it too much out of the way, over time you could bust the connector or bust something. So the cable management with this cable, I feel like personally that is the only little nitpick I have with the card, is that you're going to have a cable covering up your beautiful side profile of this GPU. But of course, if you decide to vertical mount it, that's going to be absolutely fine, because I did end up throwing this card into a case as well, and lo and behold, the temperatures were pretty much identical to the test bed with 23C ambient temperatures when I started testing. Though the one cool thing about this cooler is one of the fans will blow a lot of the hot air out the rear of the card, and then the second fan on the back will pretty much get lukewarm, so it's not really going to affect your memory or your CPU temperatures a whole lot. However, of course, if you are overclocking your RAM, especially, and you're getting seriously high overclocks on your DDR4 memory, this fan may introduce that little bit of extra heat. So do be careful and do keep that in mind. Though onto the power consumption numbers, the 3080, this is a power hungry GPU. With all that high FPS, you will need a good power supply to power this thing. And when I tested it 4K Shadow of the Tomb Raider, I decided to do 4K benchmarks to minimize the CPU impact, but since the FPS is so much higher than all the other cards here, it will draw more power from the CPU in the comparison, and that will in turn, unfortunately, skew the results against the 3080. But that being said, naturally, it is using more power than all the other cards here, despite it being on Samsung's 8-nanometer node. Though now it's time to move over to ray tracing and also DLSS 2.0. where both of these I feel go hand in hand, especially at 4K. Though I will say one thing, it definitely, in my opinion, depends on the game if DLSS 2.0 is going to be for you. For instance, I did get around to testing Anthem, but I ran out of login attempts before I could complete the numbers on that benchmark, so I had to scrap that whole benchmark completely. But I did get to test out DLSS 2.0 in that game, and I didn't think it looked as good as, say, Mech Warrior 5, where DLSS 2.0 looked really good in that game. And also in Fortnite, I feel like the DLSS 2.0 solution is really good to give you more FPS, coupled with ray tracing, where they go hand in hand, because ray tracing will have an impact to your FPS quite significantly. Though the ray tracing in Mech Warrior 5, as opposed to, say, Fortnite, they did look different. I think what they've done with Fortnite and the implementation of ray tracing is a really good job. However, it will tank performance on the maximum settings, so you will want to turn on DLSS, in my opinion, and maybe drop some settings on both the graphical settings going from epic to high, for example, and also on the ray tracing, maybe not turn it on maximum. Though for what it's worth, the RT performance wasn't leaps and bounds ahead of the 2080 Ti, but it was pretty much right in line with the raw FPS performance increase numbers of roughly 40%. The last thing to go over is the encoder, and I'll just put up the example here for you guys, where we've got the 1080 Ti versus the 2080 Ti versus the 3080. And I didn't notice really any difference between the 3080 and the 2080 Ti, but you do get three simultaneous recording streams out of the 3080 versus the 2080 Ti, for example. Though the quality difference between, of course, Turing and Pascal was a significant leap in terms of recording quality, but then going up to the 3080, you've still got really good recording quality, and it's going to be a really good solution if you're streaming off your GPU, which in this case, you've got a lot of GPU horsepower to stream off. And with all that out of the way, we're now at conclusion time with the RTX 3080, and more specifically, the Founders card. And at $699 US or $1,139 Aussie dollars, this card is just quite simply a phenomenal buy if you can afford it and if you can get the most out of it. And I do say those ifs, because if you have a 120 Hertz 1080p monitor, you're going to be wasting your money on this card. But if you want to get into, say, 4K 120Hz OLED gaming, then this card is going to take you there, and it's going to honestly change your gaming experience. When I jumped onto the 4K OLED at my brother's house, I was like, wow, this is finally what I have been longing for as a PC gamer all these years, where for the last 20 years we've been throwing LCDs and there hasn't been much innovation. 4K OLED is definitely where it's at as a PC gamer, and your eyes will thank you later. But the thing is, this is the card that's going to get you there. Of course, the RTX 3090, which is coming, but that's a significantly different value play than what this card represents right here. The 3070, that's gonna, from what I know, perform similar to the 2080 Ti. And so I feel like this, for the extra $200 over the 3070, is going to be the one to get if you wanna get into 4K gaming and you wanna get really good FPS. And so I just can't fault the 3080 at all. I think if you go with the Founders Edition or if you go with the custom AIB board partners, you're going to be getting a really good gaming experience. Though I will say about the Founders Edition in itself, it checked out okay. There was nothing, I guess people were worried about this cooler design, but at the end of the day, it's two fans on a heap of metal, and the faster the fans spin, the more heat they're gonna dissipate. So that's exactly what these two fans do. I mean, there's people on both sides. There's people that were really worried about the design. There was people that were really curious about it. And for me personally, I was thinking to myself, how much better can it actually get than just fans cooling metal? And it doesn't really get that much better. Anyhow, guys, the RTX 3080, absolute home run for PC gaming enthusiasts. That's you guys out there. If you want to get one of these, then I have heard rumors about the stock levels, so you will really want to get in fast. If you really are serious about getting one, then you'll have to maybe call up your local retailer, find out how you can get one of these. Otherwise, I heard there's going to be more stock at the end of October, at least if you're in Australia. So the demand is definitely going to be there for these cards, and especially after seeing the raw numbers, the demand is going to be even more justified. And I mean, look, people are gonna say, well, the marketing team promised us 2X performance. I mean, the marketing team is going to show you, of course, 2X performance in certain titles, which this card does, I'm guessing, over the 2080. I tested against the 2080 Super. But I mean, a marketing team is just that. It's their job to market. So of course they're going to show you their product in the best possible light. Just like when AMD showcased their Zen 2 CPUs, they did the exact same thing, and you wouldn't have heard any complaints from me back then. You're not hearing any complaints from me now with marketing. And this card, though, is the real deal when it comes down to it all. And I hope you guys enjoyed today's video. If you did, then be sure to hit that like button for us. And if you're new around here and you want to see the content as soon as it drops, make sure you hit that sub button, and I'll catch you in another tech video very soon. And we got the aftermarket board partner cards coming up. So excuse me if I do look a little bit tired. There's been a lot of testing going on here because I did get my cards really late. They got held up in customs, and it was just such bad luck. Like this card right here got held up in customs for 2 weeks. So this is why the review's a little bit late, and I do apologize for that. But I hope you guys enjoy the content. And if you've got suggestions on what you want to see with these GPUs, then, and information you want to know, then do drop a comment in the comment section below, and I'll get back to you as soon as I can. And with that aside, I'll catch you in the next one very soon. Peace out for now. Bye.